Hello, welcome to Dialect. I'm Tony Gosling, Dialect's Bristol's first podcast, set up in 2001 with a Millennium Grant from the Scarman Trust. We're on Bristol Community FM 93.2 every Tuesday at noon. That's bcfmradio.com/dialect. This week, well, we're spending best part of the hour down at Glastonbury Abbey, which is just an hour down the A37, where history was made in 1539 in the Dissolution of the Monasteries, where Henry VIII, who executed the Glastonbury Abbot, Richard Whiting, because he wanted his money. Simple as that, folks. So, the Abbey was founded in the 7th century, 712. It was going for 800 years, dominating the south-west of England. We hear now from two of the education department people down at the Abbey. That's Mark Hutchinson and Luke Loder. Dialect's produced by volunteers. We're online at dialectradio.co.uk and based at the People's Republic of Stokes Croft on Jamaica Street. If you have a story or would like to volunteer, have a pen ready at the end of the show.
I'm Mark Hutchinson. And I work here at Glastonbury Abbey, a part of the Living History Education Department. Day to day, I show tourists around, expand and explain the history, and when I have time, I then do the research.
What about local school children? I mean, I'm thinking really of actually primary and secondary age. I mean, this is a fantastic place for them to be learning, isn't it, surely?
Yes, that's why we have an education department, and Luke, who we're going to be speaking to shortly, helps run that. And we have children from Bristol, from Dorset, we're from France and Germany. We have all over the world, we have young people coming, hundreds and hundreds of them every year.
This is a little tiny chapel. It's like a little mini chapel.
This is St Patrick's Chapel, built by Beer, and this was a number of different buildings, and he sort of constructed. This was really for the women who were in the almshouses, which are behind you here. They've been knocked down. These were for the poor women. They were about sort of 9 or 10.
We've got murals around the walls here of what looks like people thinking about the building. I mean, they've got small models of parts of what looked like the Abbey here.
You can explain the whole history from here. So we start with Joseph of Arimathea, supposed to have come here nearly 2,000 years ago, and that's him landing, and the Holy Thorn nearby, because he climbs up Wirial Hill.
Joseph of Arimathea, he was the guy who was in charge of burying Jesus after he was crucified.
That's right, yes. And his tomb was used to bury Jesus. We believe.
Didn't he also have some sort of authority in the Jewish faith at the time?
Supposedly. The difficulty is that there's, in history, there's lots of interesting anecdotes. To get the actual proof is difficult. He may have had.
Okay, so is a rich man. Is Joseph of Arimathea coming to Glastonbury just a myth? You know, designed to sort of drum up tourism?
No. Hello, I'm Luke Loder, anyway, yeah. And I'm the learning assistant here at the Abbey. In terms of Joseph of Arimathea and the legend, I always say it's very much a matter of personal belief. Some people really believe that Joseph came here following the crucifixion and established a Christian community here at Glastonbury. Other people believe it might be part of the kind of web and fabric of the mythdery, as it were, of Glastonbury Abbey, which very much the monks themselves would promote, giving themselves a bit of credence as being this cradle of Christianity within Britain, this kind of original church, you almost say, rather than...
I think you could probably say during medieval times this was rife, wasn't it? Because there wasn't any real ability for people to check facts. And so there would be all sorts of artifacts, things that were supposedly, I don't know, even one of Jesus's toenail clipping or something, you know, it would be almost impossible. Of course, there was no DNA or anything to find out whether this was really actually connected with...
Was it fake news? You know,
yes, exactly.
Fake news isn't new, Donald Trump.
Yeah. No, we definitely touched upon the idea that, you know, many people, there's not a lot of provable evidence for a lot of these claims, and the church is the ultimate authority on these matters. And it's all about the way they you know, build the environment. You know, a lot of times when you come to services within a church in a medieval context, The priests are speaking in a language you don't speak, in Latin. They're often hidden behind a screen. You can't see what they're doing as part of the ceremony or the ritual. You know, I'm up at the top of the church, maybe in the choir. So it's got this almost otherworldly aspect that you're part of but slightly removed of as well, because although you're part of the service, you never quite understand what is happening as part of it.
So just explain how things have changed over the years to bring priests not only out from behind the curtain, but actually sometimes in a very informal context nowadays, with a circle, with the priest as part of the circle in church service.
Yeah, sure. Well, I suppose you've got the whole idea. It starts way back at the time of the Dissolution, and this is where we get kind of Luther and people like trying to make the church a bit more accessible to everyone. The idea that following the Dissolution, we have the Bible, of course, being printed in English, a language a lot of people can understand. We also have at this time a great period of an almost social enlightenment. There's a lot more people who are becoming literate, a lot more access to education. So, of course, naturally, this will spread amongst the people.
So this is the 1500s, the Reformation.
That sort of period. Then we also see the following of the changing of the structure of church services. So you might find a priest will do small things and say, like a mass, rather than addressing the altar, he will turn and address the congregation. So you're bringing them into it and being part of it, speaking that language you can understand. So they're opening it up to a more accessible and more of a personal religion rather than a religion through proxy, as it almost has been for hundreds of years with the monks. And having that religion of proxy allowed this kind of monastic environment to flourish and grow and become particularly impressive. Anyway, Mark, okay. Maybe the best person.
Could you just take us around some more of these icons?
Here's St. David, believed to come here about year 500, and he's holding a church. He's believed to have added to the church, which was the original sort of wooden one, believed to have been built by Joseph of Arimathea. And then we get St. Deruvian and St. Fagan, isn't it, here? Again, French monks.
This is all about the founding of the Abbey,
absolutely.
Isn't it?
5th century?
In Glastonbury. We've got evidence from the 5th century recently dated from a site called, the Beckery and Bride's Mound down on the edge of Glastonbury, a small, possibly monastic religious community of some kind founded then. And we've got evidence on the site here from the, if not late 6th century, certainly by the 7th century, there's evidence of Christian activity on the site here.
This is amazing, really, isn't it? You think about Constantine converted, I think it was the Roman Empire, converted, supposedly, anyway, to Christianity in the mid-300s. So it's not long after something going on here.
No, not at all. So there could be some kind of connection. We do see what is not necessarily unusual, but in this area of England, it's certainly unusual for the rest of the UK. We do see what seems to be some form of continuity of that original sense of Christian church right the way through to the founding of the monastery here. So this is through the Saxon occupation of Britain. Of course, the Saxons coming here aren't Christianized themselves. So they come over bringing back their Germanic pagan roots. And that takes a good 150, 200 years for them to fully convert to Christianity after they get here. But there is a suggestion that if during that time there is some form of Christian community here, there are still overthrows and shadows to foundation of a very early Christian community here that hasn't gone away and almost has a unbroken continuity through that period, which is rather intriguing.
There's St. Patrick here. Here we have St. Patrick, and again the glass up here with the snakes, because he's believed to have got rid of all the snakes from Ireland. He lived in the west of England here before he was apparently taken as a slave to Ireland. He escapes and then goes back to sort of try and bring them some sort of better way of doing things and capturing slaves. So
now, look, before we go out and have a look at the Abbey, or what's left of it, can we just talk a little bit about the history of this part of the country, Wiltshire and Somerset? What do we know about, I suppose, what's the prehistory, really, before the Romans? Do we know much about what was going on around here?
Well, we do. I mean, from Cheddar Caves, from just over the border into Wales, one of the first inhumations, that's one of the first burials, deliberate burials in Europe. We have Stonehenge, we have Avebury. So we know that life here goes back. So that is what we're building on, and possibly much before that as well. The wider context is man's search, people's search for, you know, why am I here, what's going on, who's controlling things.
Well, I think we're still on that one today, aren't we?
Yes, I think we are, and I think that's the driving force behind what people have been doing for years in trying to work out what's going on, who's in charge, how can we alter this. And that shows its way through the buildings of Stonehenge and, of course, Woodhenge before then and various other things. Where the earliest burials with grave goods. Why do you put something in someone's grave if you don't believe there's some otherness, some numinous something out there that you're trying to struggle and understand who keeps the cosmos together? How does it all work?
We're very lucky in the UK that across the UK there's a huge amount of evidence for prehistoric activity in these areas, just as much as, say, up in Scotland, especially over in Wiltshire. Of course, you've got the whole Avebury Stonehenge landscape, an entirely, not necessarily sculpted landscape, but an adapted landscape that appears to be changed for wholly ritual function and use alongside normal living. When you go into other counties, you see small sites that hint at this sort of continuation of search and religion. You go near up towards Bristol, and you've got Stanton Drew, the stone circle up there. You've got evidence even on our doorstep in Glastonbury of this kind of idea of searching for something through another worldly sense. For example, you've got a lot of ritual depositions in the wetlands surrounding Glastonbury. So when people were inhabiting this area in roundhouses from the Neolithic, building trackways across the waterways to reach, we find that off the edge of these trackways there were some exceptionally valuable for the time artifacts which seemed to be deliberately deposited into the waters. Whether those waters are being treated as a liminal point, a bridge between worlds, you're sacrificing your belongings to something otherworldly, an object that to you might be very valuable, a deliberate deposition. In Glastonbury itself, we've got on the tour one of our highest points, and what many people in the world still today believe to be one of the most sacred areas of Britain. We find there's a Bronze Age cairn, a burial up there, again, on a high place, you know, close to the heavens, visible by all from far around, and that kind of idea that you're searching for something and kind of putting your own ritual imprint upon a landscape. You're creating your own mythos to help explain things and using the landscape to that advantage.
The tour is what everyone thinks of when they think of Glastonbury. Was it man-made? And what's the old church tower doing up there?
Well, as far as we know, the tour is a natural geological phenomenon. It's basically a large sandy stone outcrop left over from the last glaciation period. As the glacier receded and dragged up the levels, it left behind the tour. And so it is a natural hill. And what we see on top of the hill is what was left of the Church of St. Michael. And that was, depending on how you view it, either a separate church or a church that was slightly linked to the monastery or maybe an outpost of the monastery, certainly being run by the monks and under the ownership of the abbey and administration of the abbey. That fell into disrepair around the time of the dissolution. It wasn't the original church on top of there. The original church apparently toppled during an earthquake in about 1275, so there's been a couple of churches up there. It is also one of the earliest sites for at least Christian-orientated worship evidence archaeologically on top of the tour. They found pieces of a crozier, a bit like a kind of bishop or priest's staff, a fragment of an early wheel cross that would date to around the early 600s, if not the very late 500s, if you're being a bit optimistic about it. So the tour's a very interesting place and certainly has had a lot of importance put upon it by people, whether in the past, historically, or today, and there are many modern myths around.
It's your logo, isn't it?
Yes, it is our logo, yeah. one of the things
we've got up there in the stained glass window, so you can see St. Michael, because St. Michael, interestingly, is the patron saint of many churches on hills. So you have Mont St. Michel in France, Mount St. Michael in Cornwall, and there he is. And he's the dragon slayer, not St. George. We get it so wrong. St. Michael is supposed to be the dragon slayer. So in social terms, he's the one who's dealing with these terrible things that go on.
I mean, this is a big thing in British iconography, isn't it? The St. George and the Dragon. What's the real story behind it? Well, it's not St. George, sorry, St. Michael and the Dragon. I believe the dragon always strikes me as being some sort of, you know, obviously a mythical beast of some sort, but yeah, maybe a dinosaur or something?
Well, I think it's less to that and more symbolic. I mean, you see all throughout medieval text, imagery, even in medical texts, for example, herbalism books, you always have a picture of someone, say, picking a herb out of the ground in one hand, and on the other hand he's got a sword and he's slaying a serpent. The serpent, a worm, a dragon, a reptile, whatever you want to call it in the medieval world, usually represents evil or not necessarily evil, or a struggle to overcome of some kind. And I suppose the idea of St. Michael slaying the dragon is about kind of protection, possibly renewal, this idea that you're overcoming problems and overcoming difficulties.
So how did St. George usurp St. Michael's role there?
I don't know particularly, no.
Is that the dragon in Western mythology, as Luke has just been saying, was very sort of a bad character. But you get the same dragon from Eastern mythology in China, and they're good, loving things. They're the ones that calm and comfort you, and you have those as nice, cuddly things, whereas here they're fierce and horrible, violent, yes, far-breathing and really terrible thing.
No, I think this is the sort of thing maybe that some of the monks at the Abbey, when it was in its heyday, would have been thinking about these things and would have been uppermost in their minds. Hence, I suppose, you know, the icons and the, some of the stained glass that was at the time. Probably today we've come beyond that. But anyway, let's...
People believed in this evil. They believed in these spirits. I mean, that's the whole thing. As 21st century people, we go, ha, 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 you know. But this is what they really believed, and they were frightened, and this is a genuine thing.
Going back in the past, you see it all throughout many cultures. The Romans hanging various herbs by the door to ward off evil spirits. Even going forward to the early modern period, there's a big fears of witchcraft and people taking that incredibly seriously. Well, we still found around the UK, you know, witch marks and things burned into doorways and people putting protections and charms on their houses because this was a real threat. It wasn't make-believe. This is 100% concrete and might happen to you. And part of the reason for that is they often don't have a way to explain malaises and illnesses. So if you've got someone who perhaps has got a severe learning difficulty, they might be considered to be possessed by some spirit.
It sounds to me like you're saying that the church was a hotbed of superstition.
Well, very much so. And I think many religions are, if I'm being honest, a hotbed of superstition, because it's about a way of explaining what you can't explain at that current time. It's about a way of making up for that. And superstition and doing little rituals to try and protect against these things is kind of all you've got, almost. And that's very much...
That's the same today. We were talking of people back a few thousand years ago giving offerings into water. You go to Bath, and what are people throwing into some of the water there? Coins. And that's no different. Wishing wells, that's right. And so we're actually perpetuating what our ancestors have been doing for thousands of years. And it's the same with stones. I mean, you think of Stonehenge, we put stones up. What do you do when someone dies? You know, you put a gravestone up, or you put a stone plaque, you know, where the ashes are. Things haven't changed, in a sense.
All these kind of things. It's all about that essence of spirituality, that understanding loss and grieving, and understanding events that have happened. It's about a way of marking it in time, but also a way of socially getting beyond this point and finding a solution and a final full stop point to it.
Yeah. Life is ephemeral, it's gone, but trying to leave something permanent to mark the importance of that.
Exactly, and going back to, you know, there's, you know, you've got gravestone today, as Mark said, you've got a burial mound in the past. It's a visual icon of we were here, we did something, remember us and don't forget us, that kind of...
Well, let's go and have a look at the Abbey ruins, which are, in a way, exactly what you're talking about there.
Well, we're standing here in what was called the Lady Chapel, which was the first religious building supposedly built in Europe over 2,000 years ago. And this is a very special place because it's built on top of other spiritual sites here, possibly going back at least 10,000 years.
Okay, well, it seems to me, I may be wrong, is that we're in the sort of the nave of what at its heyday would have been the Abbey. So we've got the ruined walls both sides of us and some arches over the top of our heads as well.
Yes, and the building would have finished at this arch that we're looking at here. So this would be the first building built after the fire of 1184 that burnt down the original Saxon church.
Okay, just trying to put this in some context, this would be just after what they call the Great Schism, which was the big split between Rome and Constantinople, between the Eastern Church and the Western Church. Now we now think of as the Eastern as the Orthodox Church, that's Russia and Greece, yes, and Eastern Europe, places like that, and Rome, which was all places west, I suppose.
Yes.
So that's around the time, not long after that had happened.
Well, that's right. But, of course, the first church here 2,000 years ago was actually before that. We have no evidence of that, and so we have this very interesting building built here to sort of represent it's retro architecture. If you look, you'll see the sort of rounded Roman arches rather than the pointed Gothic-y ones.
Actually, you've got both here, haven't you?
You can certainly see that as we go up into the main church later on. You'll see a blending of architectural styles. And what they're trying to do here overall is, as you said, retro architecture. They're trying to make the building look older than it is. We have this heritage of Joseph of Arimathea coming here, possibly becoming the first, you know, Christian foundation in all of Christendom or all of the world at Glastonbury, according to the legend. We then have a later, very early Saxon church built on the site, which is definite recorded history. We know there's a Saxon monastery here all throughout the Anglo-Saxon period. There's a very large, very affluent monastery. Then it burns down in a great, what we presume to be an accidental fire.
So it was a wooden structure, was it?
A lot of the Anglo-Saxon buildings would have been wood. There would have been stone elements to them, certainly, especially a large monastery of this calibre would have had a very fine quality carving. But certainly these buildings would have been timber framed. The roof would have had a lot of timber work in them, and that's very susceptible to damage by fire.
And so would that have been a deliberate or accident?
We don't know. No idea. We know that it's in the year 1184-ish there's a fire, or as it's recorded, and that is mirrored by some of our archaeology we find on the site for a burning layer in the archaeological record. It says there is a fire. It's unlikely to be a malicious act necessarily, because that would have been a massive expense
but
cost.
Surely there's hardly anything left of the Saxon church, you know, so it might have been when the Normans came along, there was lots of accidents that happened to the Saxon church.
But then this fire happens over 100 years after the Norman conquest. So we're talking by now, this is very much kind of Norman English land, you know, kind of the foundation of the what we call the modern kind of medieval state
start. Did the Normans start to think, well, they were starting to think about building cathedrals and that sort of thing? They think, well, we just need to get this old, wooden old church out of the way.
Well, we know there's a lot of modernisation at that point. Now, Mark, am I right in thinking that the cloister by Henry of Blois would have been built before the fire?
Yes, there was
so
cloisters
there was
here.
There was modernisation here prior to the fire, which doesn't tie in with the fact of this being a deliberate act, this fire. So we had a beautiful new cloister built out of blue lye stone. It would have been stunning at the time. And this is built before this great fire happens, a modernisation. So it doesn't tie in with that narrative. If we're rebuilding already, a fire happens and destroys what is left. It doesn't really make sense for that to have been a deliberate fire when there has been investment from post the Norman conquest.
The technology had moved on.
Yes, and style was getting old.
This is where we're standing now, was rebuilt for the wow factor.
Yes.
Now, if you just move over here, you'll see that some of the stonework here would have been actually covered in gold leaf. This is hand-carved stone covered in gold and silver leaf, sparkling away. There would have been, on that east end wall there, would have been this beautiful lapis lazuli paint from the most expensive stone in the world from Afghanistan. So you come in here and you see all these things sparkling. You see these beautiful colours. And where have you come from? You come from your little wooden house with no windows, because glass was only for the mega rich. No chimneys, because the technology hadn't been invented for everyone.
Back earthen floor.
And so you come from this damp, dark, smoky, because the smoke went through the roof, and you come into here, and you go, wow! It is absolutely stunning.
Obviously, people do go to ruins like this around the country. They go into churches. Can you just give us a sort of idea of how to read some of the architecture? Because we've already talked about the Roman arches and the perpendicular arches. Give you an idea of age.
In terms of architectural styles, I mean, you've got this Roman or Norman style, as we like to call it sometimes today, Romanesque styling, that this building is draws a lot of interest from. And we're talking there, we're looking at the 11th century onwards for about 100 years, give or take. You'll find lots of rounded arches there, lots of jagged designs, like toothed designs. You might see around us here, we've got these kind of jagged teeth in the windows and the things, I like to call them dog's teeth, but they look kind of very emotive of that style. Lots of rounded arches in intersecting and things like that. And we then move on to kind of an early Gothic, which is pointed arches, but they're gentle points. They're not really violent, high Gothic Dracula-style castles necessarily. We're looking at these kind of gentle, like you might see ahead of you, these kind of gently curving arches, still nice gentle curves leading up. And then as we go forward, you start to get to high Gothic, which is kind of the height of medieval grandeur as well in decoration. And you might see a bit of an image of some of that by looking at the Tower of St John's Church over this, kind of the top of the tower.
Oh, that's the church that's on the high street here.
On the high street there, so that's kind of more of a high Gothic style. So as we go through the medieval period, things change. And if anything, in some ways you can feel the architecture is getting slightly more harsh, I always think. You go from these nice, gentle, rounded shapes and everything gets a bit more pointed. However, that being said, you can read a bit into this architecture and maybe a bit about the focus and reason for it. We go from something that's very rounded and very kind of almost naturalistic and accommodating to the eye, and then we go towards architecture that focuses your vision upwards. The point of these arches, these is you naturally look up. The first thing people do when they're looking in a modern church, often that's been built in the late medieval period, is you go into a church and most people will immediately have a quick glance up to the ceiling, whether they're aware of it or not. And that's because everything is making you look up. The arches are pointed, the columns are high, and you're going in and your sight is being drawn
up. You know what, I'm going to question what you're saying a little bit there, because I wonder whether these round arches were as good at supporting the masonry above it than the pointed ones. Yes. Surely the pointed ones are a little bit less likely to have the weight on top of the arch,
there's a genuine kind of, you know, architectural reason for having pointed arches, fan vaulted ceilings, flying buttresses added on, which all look a bit more vertical and a bit more pointed. There's certainly that element to it, but in doing that kind of style, you can't always discount the idea of ulterior motives to this as well. They go hand in hand. You know, it's like we find many styles, and we might find these pointed arches aren't the most efficient style as for supporting these buildings either. But the suggestions, what I'm trying to get at the idea is that we shouldn't just look at these things as purely architectural styles. There's a lot of other connections to it. So we're looking at, how these would play to the human emotion, the human experience of visiting these buildings.
And these Roman arches here, these Norman Romanesque arches, I mean, this is over-engineered architecture. It is far too big, it needn't be this massive for holding it up. And that's where the whole thing developed. And being retro, this was done in a retro style, because Gothic period was here when this was built.
So this building was built when very much we should not be building buildings in the Romanesque style. By now, the common trend was to build buildings in pretty much what we call kind of early Gothic. But what they've done here is they've deliberately built it in the Romanesque style. And as I said earlier, that links back to the idea of that what they're trying to say is, although we don't have this very early monastery existing on the site anymore, they're showing, look, guys, we are older than we actually look. We are the cradle of Christianity. We are the original church. You know, it gives the credence and fits that image of this very early building.
Now, where we're standing, it looks as if the floor has collapsed here. Am I right? And there's an altar in the crypt, isn't that? I mean, that's what it looks like.
Yes, that's St. Joseph's Chapel. That was built, the whole thing was dug out. That's why we have no archaeology of the first early church here, because it's all gone. That was dug out many hundreds of years later to allow more people in. So that's St. Joseph's Chapel, Joseph of Arimathea, and this here we are dedicated to Mary up here.
So where we're standing is roughly the original floor level of the Lady Chapel, of the Mary Chapel. So you can imagine the floor sweeping across at this point here an undercroft chapel, you could call it, down below us. And
I mean, I'd say you've actually got quite a lot of stone missing from...
but look at the house at the end. You see
the stone, yes.
the recycling. We're here, we're great about recycling in the 21st century, trying to get rid of all the plastic in the oceans. Absolutely, we need to do that. But this isn't new. Recycling and looking after. And so people came and took the stone. If you look out over here, you'll see hardly a stone left of where the monks lived, because monks weren't always that popular at that time. Here in the spiritual heart, we still got quite a lot of the stone. Why is that?
maybe a sense of reverence, whether or not the people who were here prior to the dissolution, while they're quarrying the abbey, whether or not there was a slight reservation to knock down these places that were perceived as being sacred or still sacred in some way. There's always that sense of reverence to something that's old and of a religious nature.
Also, some of this might be quite difficult to knock down if you didn't have the kit to do it.
Knock down the rest of it.
But
with dynamite.
I definitely think there was some kind of continuity and at least concession towards this being a spiritual place. And that probably or may have influenced their choice in where the exact stone came from. And especially, we're down in the oldest part of the abbey, in one of the lowest parts of the church, where you'd think, actually, this is one of the easiest places to get stone from, but it is the best preserved out of all it, because this was viewed, probably throughout the whole monastery's life, as being, if not the, but one of the most sacred parts of the site. That idea that, do we really want to be destroying a sacred place, whether or not it's in line with our exact church doctrine at the moment, it's still a sacred place. And even that idea of superstition, you don't go there and you don't destroy certain things. You look at the way we know that the Saxons treated Roman sites, you know, the idea that they tended to shun them, live over the other side of the river from the Roman towns because it's full of the spirits, the ghosts of the past, something they don't understand, you know, it's something otherworldly, something different. And there's always a sense of reverence to these older buildings, and that's probably, in my opinion, why they left so much of these parts behind.
But it's interesting. I mean, you go to Rome or Greece, and a lot of the ancient temples have all gone. Yeah, and so, I mean, there is reverence in places to the sacred, but in other places, they sort of
to public opinion at the time. I mean, if we just go through the door, I'll show you an idea of public opinion at the time throughout different periods of English history. Religion and doctrine in religion and practicing religion has changed greatly. And I don't know if you can see in the wall right next to us here, there's a number of pock marks in the wall. And these are actually left over from musketry practice during the English Civil War when the Royalists was camped here at Glastonbury. And obviously they had soldiers here who wanted to practice their drill. And you find all...
Well, this is around about, just trying to place it, this is about 100 years after the dissolution.
Just over 100 years after the dissolution. We know that at the time there's quite a strong Protestant kind of puritanical view in England at the time, and this is all idolatry behind us. So now the abbey at this point is idolatry, it's not current. And then you find all along,
I thought that was the other side. I thought that was Cromwell's lot.
Well, it is, but I think there's a bit of crossover. I think there's a fair bit of crossover at the time. I don't think anyone particularly prescribed. But if you look along the whole southern edge of the church, you'll find these musketry marks in the wall. And whether that was done out of an act of deliberate irreverence or whether it's more we have a convenient backstop to our musketry practice, but it does view that at that point they're not viewing this as something that was particularly special necessarily.
That's the first time I've thought of Glastonbury Abbey as a rifle range.
Yeah, well, exactly.
Okay. People are taking pot shots at the abbey for years and years and for centuries.
Into the church, then to the kitchen.
To church and then kitchen.
Yep, yeah, let's go on up through.
Oh, the sun's come out as well. Yes. Isn't that lovely? Yeah. Well done.
I see him upstairs does sort things out. You know.
Yes.
You get a good feel of the whole impression of the place from here, really, the grandeur and the size.
Because 177 metres, nearly 600 feet, when it was all opened up, what, about 400 years of building on and off?
Yeah.
And then we look from where we've just been in the Chapel to Mary, and we turn round and look up through the Gothic to where the perpendicular would be at the end, St Edgar's Chapel at the end there, just finished probably 20, 30 or so years before it was the dissolution.
Now, I'm just trying to compare this to, you know, we're stood in the ruins here, to Bristol Cathedral, for example. It's probably bigger, isn't it?
Far, far bigger than Bristol, yeah. It actually would have been, I believe, the longest church in England if it was still standing currently at this time. That 177 metre length mark is pretty huge. It would never profess to be the tallest. I always think Salisbury cheats with a spire or something like that, but the length is certainly, you could call it magnificent, and that's probably what they were aiming for, the whole kind of grandeur and size.
And also,
so we've got quite a lot of ruins at each end, but quite a lot missing here in the middle.
Yes.
So this is where you think most of the locals would have grabbed the bits of rock to build their houses for?
Various times over history. We're very much standing in on the edge of the nave now. So the nave would be ahead of us here. But yeah, we're certainly missing all the columns. You might see in the lawn there's some marks where the columns would have been. Okay. We're actually standing just off to the side of the north porch. So you might see there's a brown sign under some trees to our left. And you'd have a great entranceway there. That would be the north porch, the main entrance to the church here. And of course that would have been, again, massive architecture, beautifully decorated entranceway, akin to the style you might see on the edge of Wells Cathedral and things like that, but unfortunately they're all gone today.
I mean, Wells Cathedral, we're standing here. This is where the Wells Cathedral would have finished, here at the beginning of the Galilee here, okay. Is what we call. And Wells Cathedral, of course, built by the same stonemasons, mostly, and in a very similar design. But you can see that the extra bits make it much, much bigger. So this would be the west end, where just behind you standing here would be the west end of Wells Cathedral.
I'm very impressed by the size, really. You think of the Abbey as being sort of just Abbey size, but this looked as if it was enormous. What can you just take us through the way that, because there's all sorts of, I suppose you've got friars, you've got monks. In what way was this separate to the Church of England, or was it part of the Church of England? How did it fit in what the Abbey did?
Well, the monasteries were independent of the parish churches. So we're looking at a totally sort of different organisation. And each monastery varied. Although this was a Benedictine monastery, the Benedictine rule was often sort of changed a little by each convent.
So I'll also just put it in context. The Church of England had only started a few years before the Dissolution. It wasn't a great period of time.
Oh, that's absolutely right. So in 1500s, so we're talking here before the Dissolution, this wasn't Church of England at all. This was Roman Catholic. And so there were no friars here. But going back to Saxon times, that would have been very different, because I think the whole culture would have been different.
So
there.
Look, what's the difference between a monk and a friar?
A friary, they're very different. So the Franciscans and people, and the Dominicans, they were interested in getting out amongst the people. They didn't necessarily have buildings or convents that we have in the monastic movement. And so they were more interested in working in society, in taking the good news of Jesus to the society for hospitals and education.
They sound a bit more urban, maybe.
Yes, absolutely. Well, yeah. And rural, urban and rural. So monks were very much cloistered. That's why the word comes, you know, they were here. And the Carthusians wouldn't have allowed anyone else in, you know. I mean, so there were different sorts of orders.
How does the Benedictine, which this was, different to the other orders of monks?
I always like to say, whether it's 100% true or not, I always think the Benedictines are kind of the original order of monks, almost. I mean, you don't really get monastic orders in the very early period. We basically have the you know, foundation of the Benedictine order by St. Benedict at Monte Cassino in Italy, I believe, in the 4th century, in about the 4th century, give or take. I believe it's 4th century.
A thousand years before this place went down.
Is the Benedictine rule gradually travels through Europe slowly and eventually reaches England in the 10th century. I mean, prior to that point, we can say, for example, in Anglo-Saxon monasteries in England, there wasn't a rule book. There was no way of being a monk or a holy individual. Each convent could decide its own rules, as it were. And that, of course, led to a large number of problems where you can have these individuals doing whatever they want, because there's nothing to do wrong, really, because there's no rule to tell them otherwise. And, of course, that actually led to a great slump and decline in monastic living and a big problem. And around that time, we do have actually a connection with Glastonbury here, with Abbot Dunstan or Saint Dunstan, as you know now today, one of our English saints. He'd spent a bit of time in Europe and picked up the Benedictine rule. And when he became Abbot of Glastonbury, he installed the Benedictine rule in on the convent here. And this became the first Benedictine monastery in England. And that kind of kick-started a monastic reform, where this rule slowly spread throughout Britain and revitalised monasticism, because it gave a structure to what had otherwise been kind of semi-organised chaos. And under the Benedictine rule, it allowed these monasteries to flourish. However, with any rule book, there's people who don't like the rules, and then you get dissenters and offshoots, and that's where we get the Cistercians and Franciscans. They are originally Benedictines who didn't like the rule book and broke off to form their own sects and factions.
Okay, what about nunneries, monasteries, women and men totally separate?
For the medieval period, certainly, you would very rarely have any form of dual house, as it were, containing both female and male religious people. You would have visitors, certainly, going to other monasteries. We do find occasionally in the Anglo-Saxon period, certainly of certain minsters, we do have dual religious houses where we have both holy men and women living within the same house together. There are often rules that separate them, but we do find, because there's not that rule book and that kind of taboo necessarily yet from the rules established, it's not bad to have that kind of idea in that idea. When we get later on, it becomes a bit of a no-go area.
Okay, well, what's the difference between an abbey and a minster? What is a minster?
A minster was really an outreach. So you're thinking of Westminster, York Minster, and all the minsters stayed. At the Reformation, the minsters stayed, but the convents, the abbey, part of it where the monks or the nuns lived, went. And so the minsters were sort of set down to enable evangelisation of rural England, and these were sort of outposts from which friars and other people would then go.
Okay, let's just talk for a minute about the place of Glastonbury Abbey in the Dissolution, because certainly my understanding of it is that most of the abbeys around the country, the abbots did what the king told them to, and basically complied with this whole thing. We're getting rid of these abbeys now. That didn't quite happen down here, did it?
No, I don't think it did. It's an interesting case because obviously Glastonbury dissolved, one of the largest houses to be dissolved in the Dissolution.
Why would a king look at the abbeys and say, we're not having any more of that?
I think it's largely due to the land ownership and financing, to be honest. The monasteries are massive economic powerhouses. I mean, you've got, you know, Glastonbury Abbey, one of the highest incomes of any monastery in the medieval period at the end of the life, earning over about £4,000 a year.
Well, 1535, it was valued then at what, in excess of, in today's money, of £1.3 billion, give or take. That gives you an idea of the wealth. I mean, that is a give or take figure, but it would probably be more.
And what were the activities that would bring about that wealth?
It's a combination of land ownership and business investment. And what
so
you
is it just is rent collecting?
Rent collecting, very big part of it. But you've also got the idea that these places are businesses, so they invest. They invest very wisely, often very unwisely in other cases, but they do invest in businesses. You've got to remember, for a lot of the medieval period as well, there's no banking system. So if you want a loan, where do you go to get a secured loan? You go to the monastery, you know, and the monastery has the money to lend you it. For example, we know that a number of very important people at the time of the Dissolution owed Glastonbury Abbey money and things like this. And
that could be one of the motives.
Possibly something like that. But very much part of this idea of these are great financial powerhouses. The more land you own, the more income you get, the more money you can invest in. And it is really important to note that for a lot of the Abbey's history is that we view this as being very isolated in England. I mean, to be honest, now we're standing in a small town in the middle of the English rural countryside. But you've really got to remember that for the whole of the monastery's life, we're on the international medieval highways here. There was a system of canals and river systems that linked Glastonbury with the Bristol Channel. And you would be able to get on a boat in northern France or even central France, sail obviously up through the Bristol Channel and not get off your boat till you arrived close to Glastonbury. So the idea that this is on those medieval highways, commerce and trade was on Glastonbury's doorstep.
Okay, so what were their main businesses, other than obviously they're collecting rent? That's easy. Well, can be easy, sometimes a bit more awkward. Was it things like wool, sheep,
that sort of thing? Quarries, sheep, huge. I mean, sheep wool was absolutely magnificent from the point of view of income. Huge incomes from monasteries all over the country, and particularly in wool growing areas. So, I mean, wool and building mills. So, as Luke was saying, you invest in building a mill. So there'd be horse mills, windmills, water mills, all those sorts of infrastructure for roads, getting rents from roads and all that sort of thing. So, I mean, the whole thing was a big business.
A really good way of viewing the monastery here. I mean, it almost sounds a bit strange saying, but the monastery is its own centralised council or own centralised government system. The large monasteries, there was an aspect of government control from kind of the monarch, as it were, on these areas. But a lot of the larger monasteries had a lot of sway to do their own thing. They own these lands, and because they're monastic land, it's meant to almost be outside of the control of the crown. It's not crown land, it's monastic land. So the monks have this kind of almost clause, get out jail free clause, to do what they want and to make their own decisions. And so it's in their best interest to invest in this land. Because build these civil works, because that in time is an investment to produce money down there.
What sort of area around Somerset would the Abbey have controlled then? How far was its influence?
Well, we're looking at, by the time of the dissolution, we're looking at, in acreage, we're looking at about just over 120,000 acres of land. The modern county of Somerset does have just slightly more than that today, and that's, of course, spread across the south of England. In Somerset alone, they had 56,000 acres, give or take, which is a third of the modern county. So it's a huge parcel. And we do occasionally find buildings around the country with unusual coat of arms on old farm buildings. And people always ask, well, where are these from? And they turn out to be from Glastonbury or something like that. Investment, again, in land elsewhere.
OK, well, we've heard about sheep, we've heard about wool. What else would have been passing through the storehouses here?
Stonework. Also, produced goods. We know at one point there was a great tile works here at Glastonbury. You're producing, you know, tiles here for chipping out. I believe it's Cleeve Abbey has some of the tiles produced here at Glastonbury Abbey. So they're actually producing almost monastic decoration for other monasteries, almost that sort of thing.
So they're producing a lot of stuff that is used for building. Obviously, they're investing in these building projects. What about other things like consumables?
Oh yes, I mean alcohol, beer. I mean we know that the we've just been doing a project and we found that nearly 500,000 pints of beer were brewed here back in sort of late medieval times, and then when you add cider onto that, which was about 250,000 pints of cider. So I mean, you're looking at that. Some of that was consumed, but a lot of it, some of it would have been sold.
A good third of it, I believe, was earmarked for selling, as far as we can tell. And of course, because beer is incredibly important for a lot of the poor who don't have access to clean spring water. You don't have filtered lovely water like we have today. It's beer is that replacement for water in your diet. And we are talking a lot of the time about small beer here, you know, weak beer as we'd call it today, you know, looking at between 1-2% in alcoholic content. But that brewing process kills off bacteria, so beer was a life source almost for the people. It replaced water in your diet, and that also made it incredibly lucrative to invest and produce. And we do find various monasteries around the Britain do actually end up owning a monopoly on the license to brew on their land. So you're kind of almost monopolising this as well.
This is bound to cause a bit of resentment, I guess, as well, isn't it? So that may have been one of the reasons why, when the dissolution happened, people weren't so upset. What about spirits and liqueurs?
Not here that we know of. I mean, we have to be very careful.
The hard stuff.
We do know that they're producing wines, but not necessarily spirits. I don't know.
I've just been reading a document that at the dissolution, one of the abbots of another monastery near here took with him the still and everything else, and he left it in his will to the children. So at the dissolution, he took the still and all the other materials. So, yes, they were doing something. I don't know what they were producing, but yes, there is evidence of monastic movement around here having stills and obviously brewing spirits.
Now, it makes me actually think of some of the big kind of almost like supermarkets that we've got today as the equivalent.
Yeah, well, because you see timber. So not only were they controlling the stone, they were controlling timber. You think of a huge fish farm down there, down at Mere. So they were controlling fish. So, I mean, a lot of the food production was actually being controlled. So, I mean, if you think of a sort of medieval Amazon, .com. you're looking at Glaston. Just ask Glaston.
Okay. So we've been talking about a lot of the food that was produced here, and I guess this is actually stands on its own. This is a kitchen of some sort.
Yeah, it's the abbot's kitchen of the monastery. And there would have been two kitchens on the site, or two principal kitchens, one for the abbot and his guests, which were standing in now, and the other for the monks, which would have been in the monks' quarters. But we're very much standing now in the prestigious kitchen of the monastery.
So there was a very much... Hang on, there's an elite here. Yes, so if you're an ordinary monk, you're not part of the elite, are you?
No, not at all, no. I mean, as with any organisation and institution and place of business, you have a hierarchy. It's exactly the same within the monastery. And certainly throughout the monastery's history, we see this develop, as it were. Now, I always view Glastonbury having such a separate abbot's quarters and abbot's apartment. And we do see this other monastery like Glastonbury because of, obviously, the kind of exceptional status of Glastonbury as being basically, other than a couple of others, one of the premier monasteries in England. You've got to remember, the abbot of Glastonbury is an exceptionally powerful man, both politically and financially. And so he needs something to reflect that status. And this is part of that, part of an entertainment complex.
As a Christian, he's supposed to be a humble man.
Well, in essence, I suppose.
All things can go wrong at some time or other. We're sinners, all of us.
They usually do, don't they?
Usually do. Well, yeah, there is that idea. He's meant to be a humble man according to his rule and his creed and belief.
It depends who's writing the history. I mean, we do have to remember in all this that what we have is the written accounts, and we have to remember who's writing the history. And it sometimes is not the real, true, complex story.
I mean, before we talk a bit more about this building, what about how you know? I mean, have you got any records from the Abbey? Because I would imagine there would be a library here in the 16th century. Doesn't seem to be a library now. Were there any records from that?
Oh, yes. I mean, Leighton says it was one of probably the best library in the country, I believe. We had hundreds, if not thousands, of manuscripts, many of which would have got destroyed. Some have been kept, and, of course, they are in various museums and archives.
Do we actually have records of what was going on here?
So we certainly do have evidence for things happening and what goes on in the monastery throughout history. Unfortunately, they tend to be quite fragmented and scattered in terms of their direct.
Do we know what happened to the library? That sounds like quite a loss.
We really don't. All we know is that it's not here anymore. There's suggestions that it was destroyed at the Dissolution. There's local story, almost hearsay, of the pages from the beautiful books being taken and given to local merchants to wrap their wares in, and things like this. They're all a bit anecdotal. Certainly the books would have had a high value to them. It doesn't make sense for a lot of them to be outright disposed of and destroyed, because these would have been copies of ancient texts, so Greek and Roman texts, Arabic texts, and these would have been of exceptional high value. They probably, I imagine, be itemised and sold off, because, of course, books back then were exceptionally valuable, unlike today when we get them from Amazon for 2p. You're talking books have the individual value of, say, in a modern value of, £1,000 going upwards to the heavens, depending on how ornate and what content it had in it. So I always like to think, this entirely a personal opinion, that it was probably itemised and sold off or taken somewhere else.
Or looted,
yeah, exactly. Looted. A lot of these books, some of the more valuable ones, would have had covers that were decorated with, gilt, gold and silver gemstones, very beautiful leather and beautiful gold and silver clasps and catches to hold them closed. So, yeah, there would have been that aspect of possible snatch and grab about the whole Dissolution, and the lovely book slipping into a labourer's day bag or something like that, but we don't really know, and that's the sad thing. We can only surmise and guess.
Longleat has quite a good archive of some of the manuscripts from here. So does Oxford and Cambridge and the British Library. Also, Taunton. I mean, there's quite a lot of good stuff down at Taunton.
Was there actually quite a lot of writing scribes actually writing books? Because, of course, this is before the age of printing, pretty much, when in its heyday here.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, we know there would have been a large number of books produced at the Abbey. Often books were produced by commission as well. So you wouldn't just write books for the sake of writing books. There's often a purpose to it. So whether or not a new copy needs to be made, or someone has commissioned the monks to make a copy. They're also not just writing books. They're also drafting things like legal documents and conveyances, because most people don't, read or write. So even the nobility at times can't read or write. So you need someone you can go to and tell what you want on a document or something, and you'll go to a monastery. That does mean that sometimes we have scribes being paid to work in monasteries who aren't monks, professional writers as well. So it very much is an industry of writing.
William of Malmesbury actually talks about some of the documents produced here were fake, and we're back to fake news again. They were manufactured to make the abbey more important. So some of the land grabs that we've been talking about were actually not real, in the sense that we didn't really own them. We then got them because there were false documents provided. So
a bit naughty.
Very naughty. But, I mean, that is well documented that some of these are totally false.
Another reason why maybe the Abbey wasn't quite so supported by the people living around here, you know, if these kind of rumours of this kind of thing got out. OK, so what about this building here? Could you just take us through what would have been going on here? I mean, this is the sort of high-end kitchen.
Yeah, so we're standing in the high-end kitchen, the abbot's kitchen. We're in the main kitchen area here. There would have been ancillary kitchen rooms going off through either door. So we wouldn't be going outside when we exited this building. We're going to more rooms. But you've got the rough layout as to how it would have functioned. First of all, there's four fires, one in each corner. And each fire in this sort of medieval kitchen would have had its own distinct purpose and use. We're standing on the western side of the kitchen at the moment. The western side of the kitchen would have been what they called the wet side of the kitchen. And that's where we'd be cooking, or they would be cooking with water and liquids. So standing right next to us, we've got a cauldron fire. So this is your medieval hob on your kitchen cookertop. So everything we can cook in a saucepan today. So stews, soups, pie fillings, sauces, ragouts, boiling meat and vegetables, that sort of idea. And the wet side of the kitchen again. The fire opposite it, the other fire, there's actually a big drain, and that would have been the scullery fire, the fire for washing up, cleaning. And, of course, you could use the scullery fire as a cooking fire as well at times of great capacity and need. So we're in the wet side of the kitchen. That means that the other side of the kitchen, the eastern side of the kitchen, is the dry side of the kitchen. So we have a spit, of course, very important in the high-status medieval environment, the meat, the high-status food. You're producing all of your lovely meat over there, your medieval barbecue. And across from the spit, it's hard to see from here, we've got an oven in the wall. And that little oven there is later oven, but you might see if you squint in the white wall above, a large row of bricks show how large the oven used to be. It's a great industrial size oven. And what we believe that would be for is largely for pastries, desserts, cakes, again, fine food. You wouldn't bake most of your breads in that oven because you would have bakeries on site churning out loaves of bread a day, you know, quite a large number of loaves a day. So this really is your kind of high status kitchen then. So you've got your four main cooking areas, probably some room in the middle for preparation. And then to tie in this idea of importance, we would have potentially, this is kind of a modern interpretation and suggestion that we know they did have in medieval kitchens. It's more than possible they had here. We potentially would have had a head chef's gallery. And that's what this ironwork structure here represents in the kitchen. Going across, you might see a pillar base on one side of the kitchen and a pillar base on the other that isn't mirrored on the side of the kitchen we're on. You can imagine a beautiful carved gantry above there where you'd have the head chef or a steward or deputy standing to oversee all the work in the kitchen. You can imagine Gordon Ramsay standing up there shouting and screaming and swearing at his cooks down below him. But again, this is about that fine food, and he's really controlling the kitchen. Because some of the food coming through here would be very expensive spices, sturgeon, expensive fish, massively expensive produce. So that's got to be itemised and checked. And we have CCTV in modern restaurants watching the cooks. It's exactly the same thing here, having someone on a gantry.
But he'd be the sort of maitre d'hotel or something.
Oh, this is a medieval Michelin star restaurant kitchen, basically, that kind of idea.
I entertained Michelin star cooks from New York in here, what, three years ago, and I did a cooking demonstration for them. And the nouveau cuisine that we're so used to isn't nouveau at all, because actually the ingredients haven't changed. You know, eggs, cream, meat, vegetables. All that's changed in modern cooking is the technology of how we put it together and the spices and the things that we put in with it.
Well, if you can imagine some amazing banquets being produced in here. Yeah, you mentioned briefly the scale of Glastonbury compared to other abbeys around the country, and this was certainly the longest church in the country, but how does it compare to, where are the other sort of top-notch abbeys around Britain?
Yeah, other than Westminster, yeah, I'd say Westminster in terms of size, we're certainly longer than Westminster.
And land ownership and sort of wealth. I mean, you know, talking about the into the billions in today's money.
What you're talking, it's very difficult to say. I mean, what we do know is that Westminster Abbey is a good example to use because that did very much vie for kind of the title of wealthiest abbey in England, basically. If you look at kind of the records that we do have, we can see that Westminster Abbey and Glastonbury Abbey have a very similar value. We don't know what that value amounts to, as in what comprises of the value necessarily. We know that the end yearly kind of produce value in pounds, of that medieval pounds, not modern pounds, is about getting on for £3,500 to £4,000 a year, depending on, this is at the end of the abbey's lives in the late 15th century and early 16th century. Well, I don't really know what you could translate that to in modern pounds, but
far exceeded Westminster in today's terms of 1.3 billion at least. Value, and that's what Henry VIII put the value on. I mean, that's what his commissioners did. So, as we look up, as we spoke in the churches about your eyes are raised up, we raise our eyes here, and you see the beautiful, slender stonework supporting this magnificent arch. And if you went into a similar building in Egypt or in the Middle East, this is exactly the same design, and it's got huge Islamic influence. And what you're seeing at the top there is actually medieval air conditioning, which this what you're looking at there is over 700 years old.
We've got a massive vaulted ceiling here with, is it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10? Is that air gaps? Basically a giant chimney in the roof.
9, 10, yes. Well, that's where the hot air goes out, and then the cold air is sucked in through the middle, because as the air goes up, it moves faster and faster because of the dome. It then is going out through the slits at a higher speed. That sets up a vortex that actually brings in the cold air.
So you've actually got cold air coming in from the ceiling as well.
Yes, yes, and it's all worked with shutters. So they aren't there now, but there would have been wooden shutters so as to alter the airflow.
Amazing. Brilliant bit of design. Well done.
Absolutely fantastic.
and probably overlooked by most people that come through here.
And how many kitchens have stained medieval stained glass? I mean, you look at the decoration in here, and it's just sort of quite interesting.
So how come this building is still here? Because most of the buildings around the monastery here have gone, haven't they?
I think partly due to its construction and also the materials used in it. I mean, you're looking at a very large building. If you look at the walls, they're at least 3 feet thick, if not thicker. This building is built to be entirely fireproof. I would challenge anyone, not literally, to burn this building down. It is designed to be fireproof. There's no wood in the roof. There's no lead on the roof to be stolen. And that roof in itself, again, above us, is pretty much keystone construction, like a bridge. You remove one or two bricks from the side of this wall, you compromise its design, it's going to collapse on your head. You would need to put up scaffolding and slowly take it down from the top downwards. That's a huge expense. The whole point of recycling the stone is a quick grabbing of building materials, not an investment in deconstruction. We also have the fact that we know that this building went through a number of uses after the dissolution. It was a very sound, strong building. It's going to be here for a good while longer. And it had further uses.
So what uses was it after the dissolution? I find that fascinating.
Within about 10 years, the Duke of Somerset owned this building, and he brought over Flemish weavers. And you can see the holes in the wall where they put a floor in there over that side of the kitchen. And the weavers were brought over because we produced, as we've said earlier on, fantastic wool, but we were hopeless at weaving it. The best weavers in the world were Flemish, Dutch and Italian. And if you think about it, Italian cloth, Italian suits is still highly sought after. So weavers were brought in. They did the weaving up there in the light and lived down here where we're standing. And then it became a farm building. It was used by people. It was then in more recent times used as a place for worship, wasn't it?
Very brief period of the Quakers using this as a meeting house. I believe, maybe not from the original use of this as a crowd, I'm not too sure, maybe from street these ones, I'm not too sure, but okay. Yes, there's a link there to these benches. Yeah.
What's left of it?
Well, I mean, you're talking of the hierarchy. If you just stand here, just over here,
we'll get a feel for it.
You can see here where the archaeologists have marked out you can see this is the dining hall. The refectory goes all the way back here, along the wall there. This is the dining hall just for one monk, the boss monk, all right, who is the abbot, who's also a bishop. And all these buildings are part of his palace. So when you survey all this for one person and his important guests, it's huge.
Hang on, how can he be an abbot and a bishop at the same time? Isn't that cheating?
Yes, it is, but then it just shows you how important he is. So he was so important. But if you look straight ahead to the left of that fir tree, you'll see that is the refectory for, what, 50, 60, 70 monks at its height, depending if they were all here. So one monk, 50, 60 monks.
So, OK, so we're talking about a total number of monks here under 100?
Yes.
Yeah, we have very few monasteries in England ever exceed 100 in number of monastic individuals. And that's not to say that is the population of the monastery or the working population of the monastery. You might find 50, 60 monks here, but then a support staff in at least over 100 support staff or more. Remember running a vast local estate, not just the massive estate around here, but also the local environment, and running a day-to-day monastery of this size and this calibre would need a large number of support staff as well.
Well, let's just talk a bit about the, you know, what the monastery was able to give back to the locals, because one thing I do know is that there was a certain amount of healthcare that they did offer through infirmaries. In fact, Bristol, we've got the Bristol Royal Infirmary. Still, yes. It's called an infirmary. So I guess that's a hangover from the days of the monasteries.
Well, I mean, that's where it all started. Over the whole of Europe, where did you go for your education? You went to the monastery.
Well, I thought you didn't have one.
What?
An education, no.
And some people, you know, were, because of their status, were taken in. If you wanted health, if you wanted medicines, where did you go? Cadfael. All right, we've all... you went to the monastery. If you were starving, where did you come? You came here for the dole, and or as we've been looking at, for the almshouses and all those sorts of things. So the church was set up as a social institution to reach out to society to deal with those in need, and it lost its way. And that's why, of course, people were very happy to see...
There are accounts, for example, in London, slightly after the dissolution, of there being a bit of a problem with the homeless and destitute. And we have private guilds of lawyers and other individuals setting up funds to build hospices because the monasteries have been destroyed. And it would be like, not in the same context at all, but if you think of it on a kind of similar parallel to immediately removing the NHS overnight and your social services and then having the problems that fall out from that, you've got the same kind of environment on a much different scale, of course, but that similar feeling and ethos. You've got kind of this, the social services that were there at the time, not that there were many, come from the monasteries. You're eradicating that, and then you suddenly have this lack in society of this social care, almost, it's gone. And so we do see this reaction in London of guilds setting up their own private institutions to help cope with this problem, and charitable institutions. So they did certainly have this effect that was felt after the dissolution when they were gone. So there certainly is that charitable aspect towards the care.
It's huge social change. I mean, we look at the Middle East and we look at ISIS and think of the criminality of destroying. But here, under Cromwell and the dissolution, huge social change, devastation of so many of our monuments and things all went.
Can you just tell us a little bit about the Puritans? Because I understand that they actually were going around churches taking down statues. And I mean, that actually is, you were talking about ISIS. This is the kind of thing that they were doing. They were destroying some of religious artifacts and things like that. Was there any kind of logic to their thinking? What was that all about?
I think it's very much, again, you can talk about the idea of, it's all about symbolism, isn't it? You're destroying the old to make way for the new, or you're destroying what you believe is taboo or wrong or somehow unjust. And rather than kind of leaving it there for, as it were, cultural memory under whatever system, this doesn't become important anymore. So the idea is you're eradicating it, and you're making that statement. You're saying, this is bad, this is old, we shouldn't go there, this is wrong. And whatever angle you go from, it's about this sending that message of, again, we can go back to the idea of going back to prehistoric sites being abandoned or ritual deposition. Often items of ritual deposition are broken before they're put in. To get past something, you break it. And I think that's the same thing they're doing here.
Well, they certainly did that with the Abbey, didn't they? Did you mention the Duke of Somerset? Was it as simple as that, that the estate was just sold off, or what?
Yes, it was. I mean, the commissioners, and it was the Court of Augmentations that was responsible. After the commissioners were here, the commissioners would have sold off some of the stuff immediately, given pensions to the monks who needed and the staff, and some were very generous pensions.
Hush money?
Well, that's why they went. I mean, most of the monasteries went voluntarily. The abbot here, as you know, was hung, drawn and quartered right in front of us on the tour there, a very bloody end. But he resisted. Most of the others had pensions of between 80 and 100 pounds at that time, which would, in today's money, would be considerable wealth.
Considering you're looking at a lot of kind of average, for example, nuns at Shaftesbury Abbey would be given a pension of between £4 and £6 a year, depending on their seniority. Yeah. And actually, £6 a year is a reasonable living. It'd be kind of, you'd be able to live off it, as it were. So it wasn't in their interest to resist and necessarily be executed for...
As Abbot Whiting was. Let's just go back to that. This is quite a nasty incident, and I guess it was towards the end of the dissolution of the monasteries, and it was really as a result of him trying to assert his authority over the king, in a way, yeah?
Yes, very much so.
That's Henry VIII. Henry VIII wouldn't have liked that.
No. And partly because of his piety. I mean, he was a spiritual man and believed that this was a place worthy to preserve and didn't want it to go the same way.
So he was prepared to put his life on the line.
Absolutely. Some people took the money and ran, and he was prepared to put his life on the line, along with two of his monks who were the treasurers, who were accused, of course, of stealing. And that's why they were hung and Richard Whiting drawn and quartered up there, that because they hid the finances they stole from the church. That was the probably trumped-up reason.
Ultimately, you've got to remember that at the time the church has just been taken control of by the king, so if you're stealing from the church, you're effectively stealing from the monarch, which is treason. So that kind of idea, so it's...
But you see, hang on, because surely one of the things Henry VIII was doing was cancelling various debts and things like that, so in a way he was stealing from the church.
Oh, yes, very much.
It's all about money, this.
Yes. That's the whole thing. Everything about the dissolution in the monastery, it's not about Henry having a new wife, it's not about kind of various social things, it's all about land, money and power, as it always has been.
Here we're standing underneath what was the original chapel to Mary above, which was the first building on the site of after the fire of 1184. Where we're standing was dug out much later. This is the chapel to St. Joseph, who became a very important cult figure later on in late medieval times. And you can see here where the altar behind us, and you can see in the stonework that's supporting the arches above here, little holes.
Well, we're right in the very, very basement of what would have been the abbey, the crypt, I suppose you'd call it.
This would have been a good way of explaining a crypt, an undercroft. We've just been through the well. But these holes were, you'd had wires in there, or bits of string or whatever, holding various votive offerings, perhaps limbs or things that had been healed or whatever. So this would have all been here.
Hang on, limbs?
Models.
You come here for healing. You have a crippled arm, maybe. You have a broken leg. You come to the Abbey for healing, and the idea is that you leave a votive offering of a representation of that ailment behind.
So let me guess that you've got to buy that from the Abbey.
Okay. Well. They certainly might sell you one if you asked, something like that. But you can imagine then this idea of, it's not too dissimilar to this idea of necessarily tree dressing. We see people making a wish or a prayer, tying some Christmas trees.
We decorate those,
onto the tree, it's kind of make that binding, that wish binding. The same thing's happening here. You're making your wish, your hope, and then you're leaving behind this kind of method of binding. You're leaving behind the symbology of that prayer you left. It's the same kind of thing, just in a different parallel.
Okay. Well, let's get back to Richard Whiting.
So we've got the dissolution.
1536, started really sort of 1535, even before there were sort of mutterings. Whiting became abbot after Beer's death.
I mean, just also in context, I'm just thinking this is around about, what, 15 years after Martin Luther and the Reformation started. So it was
in Germany, but the Reformation didn't come here until, it didn't really kick in until after Henry VIII died under his son Edward. That's when it really kicked in.
So this was the beginning of the Reformation, really?
It was the beginning. Henry VIII resisted a lot of the Reformation ideas to begin with. He gradually softened on various things over the end, but he was still a Roman Catholic himself right to the end, although he was supposedly head of the Church of England. You can see it's all very beautifully mixed up.
Okay, so how does what happened to Richard Whiting fit in the broader context of the Reformation then?
Broader than what?
And the Dissolution.
Again, as with everything, it's back on this whole idea of power and politics. You've got an abbot of an exceptionally wealthy and powerful monastery, the premier, if not one of the premier monasteries in England, very powerfully connected at court and in powerful circles, and you've got him done away with, executed in this exceptionally violent and barbaric manner. I think the idea is that it's this political message saying that if we can topple Glastonbury, no other monastic house can even stand a chance of resisting. And then we do find a lot of monasteries surrender, of course, when they come and ask. And because it's setting precedence to this kind of the treatment of what will happen if you deny us, as it were, deny the king's commissioners. You know, there will be this reckoning to be had in this.
No, but hanging, drawing, and quartering sounds nasty. What does it actually involve?
Basically, what you would do is they would hang the individual until for a while, as it were, hanging by a noose. But cut them down before they expire, traditionally. They'll then be drawn, which usually means being tied down by your arms and legs, and then being disemboweled. Not always, but usually they try and keep the individual alive while they do this. Then they often burn the entrails in front of them. And then finally, to finish it, they'll strike the head off the body, and then the body will be quartered into four pieces. And each piece will usually be sent to a different area to display at different points of the country or different areas.
Now, this is pretty barbaric stuff, yes, isn't it? Whoever's doing this is not trying to take the moral high ground.
Yeah, this is the ultimate punishment. This is the punishment for treason. This is the ultimate punishment you can face in England at the time, as it were, other than, of course, a spiritual punishment such as being excommunicated. So this really is the most barbaric punishment you can ascribe to someone. And that's why I believe it's all about this very powerful message saying, you know, the most powerful monastery we can close and topple with this act, you know, and it's that sort of
and there was further mutilations too. I mean, men would often have their private parts cut off beforehand. Women would have their breasts cut off and various other things. I mean, it was brutality at its worst. I mean,
the idea, of course, is to send a shockwave of fear. Absolutely. A shock, and I imagine it did that, send that shockwave of fear right around the country.
Well, that's why so many of the monks and the heads of the convents took the money and went. Because Henry VIII was a very, very clever political operator, along with Cromwell. They started on the small ones, the easy ones, the ones that weren't financially sound, they began to topple, and then the whole thing began to collapse like Topsy. I mean, it was a very, very clever political manoeuvre, really. I mean, it was very, very clever.
And of course, giving an opportunity to some of Henry's friends and colleagues to take over the estates, and also absolutely quite smart. Anyway, I know that there was some sort of memorial service for the first time this year, am I right about?
Yes. 15th of November, although it was under the old calendar, so it wouldn't have been quite the same date under the modern calendar, but that doesn't matter. So yes, 15th of November, 1539, when Richard Whiting was dragged up to the Tor. He was strapped, he was brought from Wells, where the trial was in the Bishop's Palace, on the 14th November, where he was found guilty by Lord John Russell and his group there. He was then probably kept there overnight, brought here in the morning, strapped to a wooden hurdle, stripped naked, and towed up to the top of Glastonbury Tor. How many people were jeering and how many people had tears, we don't know. some people would have been absolutely devastated and shedding tears.
Thankfully, we don't see this sort of thing too much in the world today, these kind of public executions.
Well thankfully, except, of course, when you think, well, not around too much in the world. Well, we've just seen a lot in the Middle East, beheadings in Congo over the last few months. It just shows what human beings are like when we allow the base elements to come into play.
So tell us about the memorial. What inspired that? What's the point of that?
It was a local community, really, and it's important that we remember. As we said earlier, it's important to have things that mark things, like Stonehenge, like stones or whatever they are. And it was just important. And we had, 15, 16 people, all from the local community, all come and just spend some time reflecting and then thinking of what footprint. I mean, Richard Whiting left an important footprint in history. We're remembering it. What sort of footprint are you and I going to leave? Who's going to remember you in 10 years' time or 50 years' time or even 1,000 years' time or me? And it makes you think. And so, yes, we had only 20 minutes, but a time of thinking of who he was, what he did, and what the implication may be for us today in how we're carrying that sort of forward, because we're still part of the history of Glastonbury. You standing here today, holding this microphone, you are still a part, you're playing your part in the ongoing history of thousands of years of what's been going on here.
Some people see Glastonbury as a sort of magnet for nutcases. People with all sorts of crazy beliefs seem to gravitate here. What is that justified, do you think, to say that?
No. It's a bit unfair saying everyone coming here is crazy. I think the thing is that Glastonbury always has been a place where people have come to seeking something. And this has been seen in the Middle Ages with the monastery being here, people coming on pilgrimage for various problems they have in their life or ailments they have. We see this going into the Anglo-Saxon period as well, and possibly earlier than that as well with the various religious sites around the area. And now today that continuity has continued. People are coming to Glastonbury. Often there's a lot of mythology built and modern religion built out of the myths and legends. And I think people come here and can find acceptance. They can find a way if they're lost in life. There's so much happening in the town from all sorts of different spiritual angles and aspects that it's hard not to find acceptance in a place to be in Glastonbury. So you can come from any walk of life and any creed, come here, and there will be people who will accept you for that.
Very much so, really. And I mean, you think we're talking about the dissolution, we're talking about Richard Whiting being hung, drawn and quartered. We're talking about the intolerance. And yes, some people would think we're weird and strange and all those sorts of things. But actually, it's about tolerance. It's about listening to one another. It's about respecting one another. And so the intolerance that we've seen in the history in the past, perhaps, I don't know, but perhaps, just perhaps, it may have made us a little bit more tolerant and willing to listen and to engage with people.
Well, the other thing is the Abbey is a symbol of today. The ruined Abbey is falling away of faith. I mean, back in medieval times, most people were believers in God of one sort or another. Nowadays, we keep hearing the opposite, don't we?
Well, you have a different faith. I mean, people have the faith that Amazon's going to deliver in 24 hours and that, you know, that you pick up your phone and it'll work. I mean, we have a different sort of faith in a sense. It's faith all the same. I mean, we don't know that Amazon's going to deliver, as they say. we don't know that. And as you travelled here this morning in your lovely car or whatever it was, you know, you had the faith that we'd get here and then you found something that sort of got in the way a bit. So it's just interesting that, yes, there is a falling away of religiousness, but actually there's a rise in spirituality. People asking questions about who are we, why are we here?
Oh, no, hang on. I think you're wriggling off the hook there, because, I mean, if you ask people whether they believe in God in medieval times, I would imagine most people would say they did. I mean, even if we're going back towards the end of the medieval times, even even 100, 200 years ago. Now, the belief in God is much less.
Nowadays, people don't often accept things at face value as much as we have done in the past. It goes into the idea of modern kind of social enlightenment and social mobility and social connection, things like that. So you're not necessarily always taking what you're told by rote, as it were. You're actually going out and investigating things for yourself. And you're allowed to question a lot more. Even 100 years ago, questioning certain things was very much a social taboo. You didn't do it. You just did what you were told and that sort of thing. And the idea that today we're becoming a lot more of a free society in many senses, a lot more freedom of thought. And so I think it allows for a lot more opening up of people to question these things. And as Mark says, that does allow for this idea of people falling away from religion. It doesn't mean they're falling away from a sense of spirituality, but they're certainly falling away from this conventional religion. They're allowed to question it, maybe nowadays is a better term of saying, whereas in the past, you haven't been allowed to question it. Even into almost the relatively recently, you haven't been able to question it. Otherwise, you are socially ostracised from your community, or it's that crazy person down the street. The idea now, we're given remit and a bit of scope and breathing space to be able to sit back and say, well, hang on a minute, is that right? Does that need to happen? Do I need to believe in this entity to be a good person? Do I need to follow this doctrine to be a good person? And the answer largely, in many cases, is no, you don't. You can be a good person anyway. I think a lot of people are discovering that and finding their own way in it. And Glastonbury fits perfectly into that, with this whole range of belief and emotion, the idea that you can come here with any belief and find something and that sort of thing.
Tony, you may perhaps be just perpetuating a Western perception that God is no longer believed in by people. Because if you go to other parts of the world, then the number of people believing that there's a God, whether it's Islamic or something else, is still huge and gaining. So it may be just a slight sort of blip from a Western point of view, from our culture and our perception. But I think if you were living in South America or some in Africa and places, that you may get a different answer to your question.
What about anyone interested in visiting the Abbey? The bottom line is, I mean, it's reasonably easy to get here by bus, although there's no railway station in Glastonbury, is there?
Under beaching, we could do with the railway.
The bottom line is, how much is it to visit if you've got a family, for example?
So current prices to visit the Abbey and come in for the day. Your ticket lasts all day. You can come in and out of the Abbey, explore the rest of Glastonbury, come in and out of the Abbey as much as you like. And for an adult, it's £8.25. For a concession or student, it's £7.15. For a child, that will be £4.95. Under fives are free with their parent. And a family ticket is to £21.45. We have our kind of season pass, as it were, our year pass. And that costs around £40. But then once you've come a few times...
By people who are living in Glastonbury,
yeah,
I imagine.
Some people who live further afield get that from Bristol, say. Because if you only come in a couple of times during the year, it's usually paid for itself anyway. So we do find people from further afield take that one as well.
What about people who say, well, you shouldn't be charging for people to come into these ruins? In fact, some people might want to come here just to be quiet and still... bit of time of prayer or something?
Yeah, well, we do have days where we have services like Eucharists in the small St Patrick's Chapel, run by Mark, who we just talked to occasionally, and they're free for entry if people want to come in and be part of that and join that. Any other forms of religious visit or religious experience, we ask that you get written permission first before coming here, but we usually are very amenable and flexible to
people. Well, look, you've got a museum. Let's go and have a little look at that.
Okay.
This is obviously very bang up to date. You've got these kind of what look like touch screens here.
This was part of a joint project we did with the University of Reading, originally to look at all of the archaeology that had been done at the Abbey for the last century and republish it and rewrite it, because a lot of the work hadn't properly been interpreted and looked at in a modern sense. And out of that research came a lot of new knowledge, and some of that knowledge we wanted to display to the public in a modern, up-to-date fashion, and so we produced these digital panels, and it very much was with the work of the University of Reading. And so we've got all sorts of digital reconstructions, information about various periods of the Abbey's history on here to see. It largely focuses focuses here on the earlier period of the Abbey's history, so the Anglo-Saxon monastery. And that's largely because until we did this research, we didn't know a lot about the earlier history of the Abbey. So now we know more about it, we've been able to display it in this manner.
Now, look, one of the things I can see immediately there is Arthur's tomb. It sounds to me a little bit like the Joseph of Arimathea myth. Is there actually any evidence for Arthur? And I always thought that it was just sort of made up. What do we actually know?
It's very difficult to say. I mean, what we do know is that the monks certainly claimed in the year 1191 to have discovered the burial of King Arthur in their old graveyard.
Was King Arthur then? Because wasn't he just made up?
Well, very difficult. We don't know if there was ever a true King Arthur. A lot of the stories we have of King Arthur today are more modern reimaginings. So Malory's King Arthur from the later medieval period is very much this high medieval knightly king who attends tournaments and jousts. We have a Victorian reimagining of King Arthur in the very same vein and light. What we seem to view today is that if there was a King Arthur, he would have existed in the time of the Saxon occupation of England, resisting this time. So we're talking the 500s, maybe dipping into the very late 5th century, something like that. So we're looking at someone who might be more of a tribal war leader or a chieftain than anyone who actually represents a king.
He sounds a bit more like Alfred. Did he just not get the name?
Alfred the Great, or possibly, yeah, I'm separated by a few hundred years. Yeah, but it's that sort of idea. And so we've got this idea of this person who could have existed back in that time, potentially. But what we do know, the earliest records we have of Arthur aren't written until the early medieval period, so we had this big gap of about 400 years anyway of narrative. And of course, the medieval writers depict stories from the past in the present day. It'd be like us doing a reimagining of the nativity set now, and that's the way every medieval kind of storyteller sets their stories. This idea is that they start writing about King Arthur, especially in the 11th and 12th centuries, and this is the height of chivalry, the height of romance in court. And so what do they represent King Arthur as? A chivalric hero with all the love and passion of court attached to him.
But they also had King Arthur's tomb, apparently, according to this. Now, this is very highly decorated. It looks incredibly impressive, but perhaps... So, a forgery.
What we genuinely had a tomb of King Arthur here at Glastonbury that was contained up inside the choir of the church. There were a number of eyewitness accounts from the medieval period of people visiting this. We had King Edward III come here to visit the tomb, and that's what this picture you see in front of you, this gaudy, beautiful tomb with the decoration of the church, is based off. It's based off a reference to the visit of Edward III. And the reference to it describes the tomb in great detail as to how it would have looked, and even talks about the skulls of Arthur and Guinevere placed on beautiful silk cushions in front of the tomb for the king to see, and you can see that down here. They also talk about the tomb being supported by four beautifully carved white marble lions, and that it's a black canopy, richly adorned. And this is very common for many high-status tombs within monastic enclosures. Whether or not this is genuine, or whether it's part, again, of this building of legacy and building of prestige and importance that the monks were very much involved in here.
And it would be a draw, I suppose. People would want to come and see this, and maybe that's why it was cooked up. I keep hinting at this, but I do think that these kind of myths actually sold the Abbey around the world.
Well, it did. Whether they are true or not, it sold the Abbey around the world. That's an undeniable fact. This is part of the medieval brand of Glastonbury, as it were. Having Joseph and King Arthur as, you know, related to these sites, it very much is about spreading the word of Glastonbury. As to whether these myths are true or not, again, we always leave that up to personal belief, because we don't have enough evidence to say they're true. We don't have enough evidence to say they're false. Okay. What we can do is we can have a quick look at the top of the museum, maybe, and show you what I believe to be one of the best pieces we have in the museum that highlight the overall magnificence of the monastery. And that would be this piece up here. This is the Othery Cope, which is a ritual vestment or article worn by maybe the abbot or the prior, a high-status monk, during an important service.
Now, it looks like, is it black? It looks very, very dark, and it's got a whole collection of what look like fleur-de-lises and angels and all over it, in kind of silver and white.
Yeah, so originally, it's a green velvet cloth, incredibly expensive. And what it's got on it is a lot of applied embroidery showing Mary in the centre. It's got angels on it. It's got, again, the fleur-de-lises and the floral patterns. And if you look closely at Mary and the angels, you will see embedded in their wings real golden wire. This is gold wire. And we're talking about an article of clothing that would have cost the equivalent or more of a labourer's yearly wage here. But this shows the idea of that high-status ritual, that high-status display of wealth, display of pageantry, and again, the display of that otherworldliness of this environment and this church. You come in here on that service, we've already talked about that before, you see all the colour around you, and you see these priests, these monks officiating in your service, dressed in the most magnificent colours and clothing, and it adds to that overall feeling of awe and something that you wouldn't really experience in many places.
What date are we talking about?
We're not entirely sure of a date of it, but definitely within the life of the abbey. It was actually found under an altar at a local church in Othery, wrapped in a tarred cloth, preserved. And of course, Othery was part of the monastic estates at the time, and something of this status certainly would not have been from a small parish church. So we think that largely it probably was one of the things that was possibly hidden after the dissolution, so that it wasn't sold off or given away, as it were, something, you know, particularly important.
Tell us a little bit about the life of the church in Glastonbury today. I imagine that you've got a parish church is now the focus.
We've got a parish church in St John's over the road. There's also a couple of other churches in the town. There's St Benedict's down at the bottom, an older church than St John's is, down on the western edge of the town. And there's a couple of other chapels, of other denomination, Methodist chapel and various other ones around the town. We also have modern alternative religions as well. So we've got a goddess temple and various other religious institutions and sites within the town itself. So it's a very vibrant and alternative and different community.
I imagine that Richard Whiting would have been rather perturbed about something like that, a goddess temple in Glastonbury.
I imagine he likely would have been, but again, we're looking at it from that filter of modernity. You know, we're assuming, of course, he would have had some issue with whatever was going on in Glastonbury today. But then we're looking at a time when Richard Whiting was about, where there was no alternative to the practiced way. The church was the church, and anything outside of that was considered radicalisation or basically heresy. Certainly something like the goddess temple, or certainly something like any other religion we see in Glastonbury today, other forms of Christianity would have been considered a massive no-go area, basically, at the time. So it's not that he would have found that particularly unusual, it's that he would have found pretty much everything we do here in modern life completely outlandish, unusual, and in some way heretical, probably. So it's
punishable by death.
Punishable by death, possibly, yeah, or excommunication or something.
Can I just ask you personally what drew you to come work here, and what's your personal journey been?
Well, I've actually lived in Glastonbury my entire life. Grew up here as a boy, went to all the local schools, and I went off to university, to Bristol University, and studied archaeology. Did a postgraduate diploma in archaeology there, and after that was looking for a job. And they had jobs here for costumed guides available, dressed up to tell the history of the abbey in a historical costume. I'd done a bit of historical reenactment in the past. I thought, this is a brilliant idea. Well, I'm in between jobs, you know, come and do that. Started doing the guiding here, absolutely loved it. The Abbey's been my playground as a child and all sorts of things, so it was right up my street. Lots of archaeology, lots of history here. And then I guess I kept making myself more and more useful until they kept me here. That's the idea.
Are you still doing research on archaeology and on the history of this place?
Very much so. The Abbey in general is always involved in research. We're always looking at our own collections, let alone collections that other people have, to learn as much more as we can. As I mentioned at the digital panels, we've just finished a large project in collaboration with Reading University that has been looking at a lot of the excavations and work that we've done over the past century to really tie up any loose ends before any new research can be done. So yes, certainly every year we're looking at things. We have a curator and a learning department that do look.
Give us an idea of some of the more recent discoveries that have thrown some light on the life here.
We learned a lot recently about, as I mentioned, the Anglo-Saxon monastery here and about its form, function and layout. Before, we knew some bits, but it was very much generalisations. Now, we've learned a lot about the way life worked in the Anglo-Saxon monastery and the way craft worked. We found evidence for Anglo-Saxon glass working furnaces on the site here, which were situated where the cloisters are today. And through the research we've recently done, these glass furnaces have been able to be dated to be the earliest glass working furnaces in Britain on the site here in an Anglo-Saxon context. And probably they're glass furnaces using recycled glass, either Roman glass from the continent or Roman glass from Britain, or maybe glass shipped in from abroad to make articles, whether it's window glass, glass vessels, glass beads. And this is a very refined and high status craft, as it were, very difficult craft to do. So we're finding all sorts of exciting things. So we could say, until another site is discovered early, and thus we're the earliest site of Anglo-Saxon glass working in Britain, and we found that out only a few years ago, for example.
Fascinating that we're still finding things out about this site. It's an absolute rich seam of history. So, Luke, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you.
That's all for this week. Dialects Bristol's first weekly podcast. You can download it to listen on your phone or in the car. Subscribe and listen the week before broadcast if you like at dialectradio.co.uk. Thanks to our guests from Glastonbury Abbey. That's Mark Hutchinson and Luke Loder. Hearing there about what the Abbey produced for Somerset, that is wool, meat, fish, alcohol and building materials, a fantastic amount for 800 years up until 1539, where the brave abbot Richard Whiting was executed under the orders of Thomas Cromwell and King Henry VIII in the dissolution of the monasteries. They just took all of the wealth of the monasteries for themselves. Thanks also to studio engineer Dave Bazanko. Dialects of Bristol Broadband Co-op production. Catch us on Bristol Community FM 93.2 every Tuesday at noon, and anyone can contribute. Contact us at the People's Republic of Stokes Croft, just off Jamaica Street, online at prsc.org.uk. You can talk to PRSC Arts Centre on 0117 909 6897 or The China Shop on 944 4540. Volunteer with us if you like, or for hundreds of opportunities across Britain via the National Volunteering website, that's do-it.org. Thanks for listening to Dialect, and I'm Tony Gosling, wishing you a very good week. I'll be back on Friday with my two-hour BCFM politics show, live from 6 till 8pm. Meanwhile, till the same time next week here on Dialect, goodbye for now.